in this new covenant, we do not walk. Matter of fact, this is a very good word. Even as we turn into 2 Corinthians chapter 5, let me show you a verse of scripture in Romans chapter 7. Many times people wonder if we are not operating in the works of the law, then what are we operating in? And if we sometimes we talk about the works of the law and the works of the flesh. Well, the works of the law, the works of the flesh, all that stuff is going to be burned up. And God doesn't bless that. God, the blessing and anointing of the Lord is not on the works of the law, and it is not on the on the works of the flesh. But they are corresponding actions of faith. They are the works of faith. And Abraham's faith was made perfect through his works. That is very important. They are issues of the corresponding action that whereby we exercise ourselves to develop a conscience that is void of offense before God and before man. That is important. Having faith out of a pure conscience, 1 Timothy, I think, chapter 1 and verse 5, I believe it is, about the end of the commandment is faith out of a pure heart and conscience. And but as we're talking about law versus grace and this covenant that we are walking in, this covenant of the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, this covenant of peace and wholeness and grace, it's a very important thing to understand. I'm just going to, as it rises up inside of me, and let me just mention it. It says in Romans chapter 7, it says, but now we are delivered from the law, being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. So in this new covenant, we walk in this new covenant to being led by the Spirit. And the Bible says if you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. In other words, if we walk in the Spirit, the flesh will not dominate us. Amen? For you're not under law, but under grace. And grace is what has been given unto us so that we can rise above the domination of the flesh. But grace is the very person of Christ. Because the Bible says that that in him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And back in John chapter 1, hallelujah, and verse 14, it says, we beheld, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The glory, full of grace and truth. The glory, full of grace and truth. Jesus, who is the Word made flesh, he is full of grace and truth. He is the glory of God, full of grace and truth. So Jesus is the embodiment of grace. So hence when the Bible says it is done by grace, we're talking about him. When we see Jesus say, my glory, the glory that in John chapter 17, verse 22, the glory that the Father has given me, I've given you that you might be one. I've given you the glory that you might be one. In other words, the glory in and of itself is to bring forth this oneness. What oneness? As he is with the Father. What oneness? The oneness that we have with God in Christ. What oneness? The fact that our soul and our body has been out of line and out of harmony with our spirit because of the fall. But Jesus says, I've given them my glory. And the glory can produce this oneness. That is why, as we teach this and we taught some of this morning, and we're going to be teaching it in the weeks to come. Many times believers get trapped in a lot of self-work and a lot of self-effort in order to accomplish the spiritual ideals, the spiritual goals, as they press for the mark, but they try to do it by the sweat of the brow. They try to do it by the works of the flesh. And the Bible says in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 3 that we've been born again, that we do not worship God, and that we worship, we are of the circumcision that worship God in spirit and in truth and have no confidence in the flesh. Amen? You follow me in that? And many times we could be caught into a place of almost what Colossians chapter 2:23 calls will worship, where we are endeavoring to just do more, pray more, maybe if I fast longer. But in fact, then this work of transformation will be accomplished. But the work of transformation is accomplished by the Spirit of God. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, we are changed from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. And where the Spirit has lordship, That's where liberty is. So the work of transformation is done by the Spirit of the Lord. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 13 that through the Spirit we do mortify the deeds of the body that we might live. It is the power of the Holy Spirit that flows through our spirit that can bring us to this place to put that flesh domination underneath us. It is Christ himself. It says in Philippians chapter 3 verse 21, he is able to subdue all things unto himself. And those all things happen, those all things include things within our soul and in our body that is somewhat rebellious to him. Does that make sense? He is able to subdue them, which means he is here. I like to think of it as the fact that when he moved in, you know what I mean? He moved in and he came into our spirit and he came up, and now that he's living here, he says, now that I'm here, you cooperate with me, you put me first, you let me be in charge, you do what I tell you to do, and here is what I'm going to do. I am going to cause my life, my power, I am going to cause everything to be brought into subjection and into obedience. I'm going to subdue all things unto myself. I'm going to make even the last enemy to be underneath my feet. He says, I'm going to do it. You just need to cooperate with me, but I'm the one who's going to do it. It is done by grace. How shall this mountain be removed? Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. Not by might, not by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord. He's the one that does the transformation. How shall this be done? It is done by grace. Who is grace? Jesus himself is the embodiment of grace. You know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Even though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be made rich. In other words, he is the very key. He is the very one that brings this about. Amen? And that is such and so that it is not about works. There is a work of faith. There is a corresponding action to our faith. There is a yielding, there is a submission, there is a humility, there is a reckoning of yourself there, there is an acknowledgement of the truth, and so on. But ultimately, it is so that the life of Christ might come forth and get the job done. Amen? All right, I kind of went off there a little bit. But what I was going to show you is, so in this new covenant, where we walk by faith and not by sight, where it's not the works of the law, where it's not the sweat of our brow, but where is the acknowledgement of the truth? Even as you have received him, Colossians 2 verse 6 says, as you have received him, so walk in Christ. So walk by faith. Now in Romans chapter 7, I was looking at verse 6 was this, and I kind of got off a little bit. And now we are delivered from the law, being dead, wherein we were held, that we should serve in the newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. The Bible says the letter kill it. Jesus says the flesh profiteth nothing. John 6, 63. But the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. Now, so he says, in this new covenant, we should serve in the newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Now, the amplified on this, I think, is wonderful. Is this what I'm looking for? Well, let me read it and see anyway. But now we are discharged from the law and have terminated all intercourse with it and have died to what once restrained and held us captive. So now we serve not under obedience to the old code of written regulations, but under obedience to the promptings of the Spirit in the newness of life. Now we are walking in obedience to the prompting of the Spirit in the newness of life. And I think that's a good word. In other words, then we must develop a sensitivity to the prompting, to the leading of the Holy Ghost. And the Bible says, when you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Galatians chapter 5, and I believe verse 16. Amen? All right. Now, originally I had said to turn where? 2 Corinthians where? 2 Corinthians 5, 17. Praise the Lord. All right. So let's take off. Boom. We have been we've been talking about this new perspective in resurrection. We are the offspring of God. That's who we are. We are the offspring of God Almighty, born of the seed of the Word, the seed which is Christ. We've been born again. not by the will of men, but by the will of God. We are the offspring of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and there's a new perspective that we are to have in this new life. And it is not that of the vanity of the Gentiles, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, where the Bible says, don't walk the way the other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their minds. And as a result, they're alienated and they are non-participants in the very life of God. So you and I, as believers, we have the life of God in us. The life of Christ is in us. But for us to be put to participate in that life, we cannot walk in the vanity of our minds. We cannot walk in carnality. We cannot walk as mere men. We cannot walk in an unrenewed mind. We have to walk in the mind of God. We have to walk in the mind of Christ. We got to walk according to the truth. We got to walk according to the word. Because if we don't, then the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 and 18 and going on to 19, it says, or else we will become alienated or separated or non-participants in the very life of Christ that is on the inside of us because of the ignorance that is in us. And if we continue to walk in selfishness or lasciviousness, it will create a darkening of our conscience, a darkening of our hearts. It will create an insensitivity to the Spirit of God. And as a result, we won't be able to even recognize His promptings. Amen? But the Bible says that when you understand that, and you recognize who Christ is in you, and you recognize the truth that is in Him, and even as you have heard, and even as you have learned of Him, and you walk accordingly, then what would happen is that your mind, verse 23, you'll be renewed even in the very spirit of your mind. To be renewed in the very spirit of your mind, Ephesians 4, 23, you have to do, Ephesians 4, 21 has to be a reality, which is that the truth of this Christ in you, and taking a hold of Him, taking hold of the truth that is in Him, and as even as you hear from Him, do. Amen? All right, but anyway, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So we continue and we're talking about this perspective of the new creation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, a verse we're familiar with, but I want to read it a little slowly. Therefore, if any be in Christ, he is a new creature, or a new creation. The Amplified says a new creature altogether. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Amplified says he's a new creation, a new creature altogether. The old previous moral and spiritual condition has passed away. Behold, the fresh and new has come. Now, this is the word I want to focus in on here is, behold. Behold. Stop. Look. Listen. Observe. Don't miss this. Don't miss what? All things have passed away. Yes, it includes that. Behold. Behold what? Don't miss this. Don't miss what? All has become new. And we need a revelation of that. We need a revelation of the reality of the fact that here you are as a new creation and everything is new. It is say some things. I mean, that is challenging. That is challenging to your intellect. Isn't it? To be able to see all things new. All right. But certainly, and I said that only to say there is a new perspective. And there's a new perspective in resurrection. A new perspective. Now, just to bring forth what that new perspective is, turn with me to Proverbs chapter 8. There's a new perspective in Revelation. Now remember, even as you turn there, going back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 and 18, it says that their understanding was darkened. Their understanding was darkened, and they were alienated from the life of God because they walked in the vanity or the futility of their minds, and their hearts were darkened. Amen? Right? And because of ignorance. But it speaks, it uses this phrase about the understanding. Right? I don't know, maybe I'm misquoting, I'm not quoting it accurately. I don't want to get off on that. I'm trying not to. It says, back in Ephesians 4, verse 17, this I say therefore, and I testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened. Having the understanding darkened. Well, here we are as a new creation. All things have become new. We need to behold. We need to have this new perspective and see what God is talking about when he says all things have become new. What is he talking about? What is he seeing? What is he speaking? What is this all about? Because I want to make sure I'm seeing what he sees so that I can talk how he talks and I can live by the same laws that govern him. Because my Bible tells me in Psalms 37, verse 21, that when you learn to operate by the law of God, your steps will not slip, which means you're not going to stumble. You're not going to get offended. You're not going to be tripped up. The devil won't be able to. He can try all his snares, but he won't be able to trap you. Amen? So, the understanding was darkened. The understanding was darkened. Now, what are we talking about? We have to have this new perspective. What perspective? Proverbs chapter 9, understanding. Chapter 9 and verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Job 28 verse 8 says it's the very essence of wisdom. But it's certainly the doorway into wisdom. And Christ is the wisdom and power of God. And the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. The knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Now, the knowledge of the Holy One does not merely mean not knowing about God, knowing this about God, knowing, you know, that he is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, you know, and there's a Trinity, and it is not about intellectual knowledge about God. Yes, it includes an intimacy of God, but the knowledge of the Holy One is the knowledge that the Holy One has. It is the mind of God. It is the mind of Christ. The knowledge of the Holy One. In other words, getting a hold of his perspective. Getting a hold of his perspective. Seeing things through his eyes. That is why it says in Habakkuk that we sit upon the wall, remember? We climb up on the tower. Why? So that we can see what he says. And when we see what he says, then we know what we ought to answer. And we can write it down and make it plain. Amen? And we can walk by faith, and we won't be puffed up in our minds. We won't be lifted up. Our soul would not be lifted up, but rather we're going to walk upright, and we're going to operate by faith because we are able to see what he has said. Are you with me? We are able to see from his perspective. So understanding is having God's perspective. In other words, until you can see things the way God sees it, until you can see it from his perspective, as far as God's concerned, you don't have understanding. Amen? Boy, how many professors don't have understanding according to from God's perspective? Are you with me? The Bible says, and I'm going to head over to Romans, but on the way, let's stop at Isaiah chapter 51. Isaiah 51 is a wonderful, well, this is the first couple of verses. Remember, Brother Abraham, or should I say Father Abraham? Amen? Now, I know saying Father Abraham sounds like one of those daycare, nursery songs. Father Abraham. Was it? Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. Okay. All right, Isaiah 51. It says, hearken to me, you that follow after righteousness. Are you pursuing righteousness? Jesus said that we have to seek first the kingdom of God and what? His righteousness. And the very essence of righteousness we've talked over the last little while is this oneness that we have with God in Christ. Amen? The Bible says in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but it's Christ that liveth in me. And the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. And then it says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. Because if righteousness came by the law, if this oneness is me being crucified, if me being crucified and the life that I now have, which is the life of Christ, if that came by the law, then Jesus died in vain. And it literally called you being crucified and now having the life of Christ in you, it calls that righteousness. And it says that if you do not receive that, if you do not receive that and you do not line up with the reality of the fact that you are crucified and it is now the life of Christ that is living in you, and that is the essence of righteousness. It doesn't get any better than that. Right? Then you are rejecting and you are receiving. You're not receiving. You're frustrating the grace of God. In Corinthians, it says you're receiving the grace of God in vain. Are you with me? And Jesus says, if you will seek first and pursue the kingdom of God, which is God first, and be preoccupied and consumed with God's ways of doing things and with God's realm and God's dominion and God's reign, if you will be possessed by that and his righteousness, he says, all these other things shall be added unto you. Amen? So it says, you that are following after righteousness, and you that seek the Lord. Now, as soon as you hear seek the Lord, you should hear fear of the Lord. Because the Bible says in Psalms 34, I believe it is, the young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. And then it goes on to say, I will teach you to fear the Lord. And then it says about seeking peace and pursuing it. Keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from speaking guile. Psalms 34, and the wrong verse 9 and 10. But the point is, you will see that the part of the fear of the Lord is a hot pursuit after God. It is a seeking of him, not seeking men, seeking him. So it says, you that seek the Lord, you that are pursuing righteousness, I'm saying, yes, come on, you're talking to me. Look to the rock from whence you have been hemmed, and to the hole of the pit from whence you are digged. Look to Abraham, your father, and unto Sarah that bare thee. For I have called him alone, and I blessed him, and I increased him, and so on. For the Lord shall comfort Zion, he will comfort all her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like Eden. That is the place where the blessing was functioning. And her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving, and the voice of melody. Hearken unto me, my people. So you, if you're pursuing righteousness and you're seeking after God, it says, look to Abraham. He's your example. Amen? Now we're talking, what's understanding? It's a perspective, it's having God's perspective, God's perspective. We're talking about the perspective of resurrection. Behold, all things are new. What's understanding? It is the knowledge of the Holy One. It's the knowledge that God has. It's seeing things his way. Abraham came to that place where he was able to see things God's way. Isn't that right? Look at Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 4. And hold that thought about Abraham as our example, because we're going to come back to that. Because there is one thing I know the Lord has impressed me to say tonight, and if he impressed me to say it, then I believe we're going to get to say it. Amen? No matter what rabbit trail come up. What do you think? Hallelujah. Romans chapter 4, and it is connected to Abraham. Romans chapter 4, and it could be seen in him. Romans chapter 4 and verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. How did God see it? Did God see Abraham? No children. Sarah, barren, not a chance. I mean, if you Google this, if you check on the internet, man, no woman has, people in this situation have ever had a child. Forget it. No. God didn't see it that way. Amen? God says, I've made thee a father of many nations. Before him whom he believed, even God, who quickened the dead and called those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations. According to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. That he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken, according to that which God had said. What God had said, he began to see. It became the vision of his heart. He saw what God said. Amen? As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed. Before him whom he believed. Have you ever, has somebody ever tried to show you something and they say, look at that thing over there. And you're there and you say, I can't see it. And they say, come, stand here. And they put you right in front of them and say, look, can't you see it? And you say, oh, yeah, now I see it. Why? Before him whom he believed. Once Abraham got in line with God, and before him whom he believed, he began to see from God's perspective that he recognized, I'm the father of many nations. And he received it, he believed it, and he began, and his name got changed, and he began to tell folks, I'm the father of many nations. Amen? The whole process before Isaac came up took 25 years, but once he came to that point and his name got changed and he began to talk right and Sarah's name got changed, within a year, Isaac was here. Did you get that? What am I pointing out? The issue of this resurrection perspective. All right. Now, let me just go straight here. So, in the resurrection, we've talked about the fact that humanity, or the natural realm, can rule us, dominate us, and create limitations in our lives. Amen. What race? What gender? Age? Education? Good looks? What a blessing it is! Thank God for my good looks. Right? Good looks. Who you know? I mean, what's in your genes, genealogy? Many of these things can create limitations. But Jesus died to redeem us from those things. Right? What's it called? Revelation chapter 5 and verse 9. And while I'm on that one, let me give you two other scriptures just along that line that supports Revelation chapter 5 verse 9 that says, not only that we redeemed unto, but we redeemed out of every nation, every kindred, etc. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 4, it says, who gave himself for us that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father. That he might rescue us and deliver us and redeem us out of, from this evil world. So that we are in it but not of it. We don't have to suffer the limitations of this world. We are not to be defined by it. And again in Titus chapter 2 and verse 14. Titus chapter 2 and verse 14. Just to support that point. Titus chapter 2 and verse 14 says, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. Not just from this evil world, but from every iniquity. And that's not just sin we're talking about. From every iniquity, from every bend, from every evil, from every hindrance, from every limitation. And purify unto himself what? A peculiar people that are zealous of good works. So we are redeemed unto and we are redeemed from. Now, As we study the sacrifice of Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, his seating on the Father's throne, his life in us and through us, the name that has been given unto us, his shed blood. As we study those things, one of the things we come to understand is that when it comes to the limitations that are in your life that come because of Adam's fall, the limitations of our humanity in the natural life, that the death of Christ, Jesus' death, is the only power that can free us from being ruled by the natural realm and by humanity. Jesus' death. Now, and let's combine that with this thought of having the right perspective. So we must now know in order to not be held earthbound by our humanity, but rather be freed from those chains so that we can be carried by the wind of the Holy Ghost and have an open heaven in our lives. In order to get into that place, we have to know specifically and understand and acknowledge the truths of what has been done in Jesus' body for us. Because you see, what Jesus did in his body is done in his body. What Jesus did in the cross has been done for us and is our, and we are the beneficiaries of it. If Jesus took our sickness, then our sickness was taken. If by his stripes we are healed, then that's what we got, is healing. If he became the curse, then then that's what he did in his body. He became a curse, then that's what is done. And as a result, the blessing is ours. We need to understand that. You need to know it specifically. Now, I'm going to run through this quickly because I want to get to a particular area. We build up on this perhaps another time. But let me just go through this a little bit. What are some of the specifics that has been done in his death, because we need to identify them. What has been accomplished in his death? Because like I said, these limitations from the humanity, it is authority of his death that gives you the power for these things to not rule over you. People many times think that the sin nature, they're going to overcome it by binding and loosing. No, you're not going to. That's not what the Bible says. Romans chapter 6, one of the things, Romans chapter 6, verse 10. Let's walk through this. Romans chapter 6, verse 10. Maybe I should read more scriptures and preach a little less. Is that right? Romans chapter 6, let's pick it up in verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man is, not going to be. This is a fact. Is crucified. Now let me back up and say something. I've said it before, but I'm going to say it again and put a little bit more emphasis on it and bring an extra thought into it. Colossians 2 verse 6 says, as you have received Christ, so walk ye in him. Which means wherever we are, it means when we talk about living this resurrected life, when we talk about being seated in heavenly places in Christ at the Father's right hand, when we talk about the name of Jesus, when we talk about all of the benefits of our salvation and to be able to walk in them, it says the way we walk in Christ is the same way we receive Christ. Excuse me, sorry. It says the way you have received Christ, so walk ye in him. And how did you receive him? By faith, is it not? You believe and you confess. Now, this process of faith, and we talked about this somewhat last week, is this believing and this speaking, the secret to that is acknowledgement. You see, and that acknowledging of the truth, that acknowledging of what has been done in the sacrifice of Christ, that acknowledging of what is already finished, that acknowledging is manifested in your believing and in your speaking. If you believe in your heart and you confess, you're saved. But that believing and speaking is what the acknowledgement is. Amen? Hence Philemon said the communication of faith becomes effective by the what? Acknowledgement of every good thing that is in you in Christ. But I want to take acknowledgement a little bit further, because acknowledging this issue of acknowledgement of what is done, what is finished, of the truth, of the sacrifice of Christ, of the truth about who you are, the acknowledgement of the fact that the life that you now live is the life of Christ, and that you are the righteousness of God, the acknowledgement of these things, let me give you this as a bit of a definition, or at least interject this into your thinking. When we are saying acknowledging, what do we mean? Here is what we mean. We mean putting it in the forefront of your thinking, bringing it to the forefront, bringing it so much to the forefront that it affects your thoughts, your attitudes, your speech, your actions, and your decisions. You understand that? So when the Bible says, for instance, in Proverbs chapter 3 and I think verse 5, in all your ways acknowledge what? Acknowledge Christ. Acknowledge the Lord. Acknowledge God. In all your ways, do what? Acknowledge him. That means no matter in all your ways, you got to make a decision. Acknowledge him. Bring him to the forefront. And let that affect your thinking, your thoughts, your attitudes, your actions. And he says, when you do that, what will happen? He'll direct your paths. And so when the Bible says, your faith becomes effective when you acknowledge what is done. You follow me? So when you start hearing that the death of Christ has accomplished this or has accomplished that, you have got to acknowledge that in order to plant it in your own life, keep it in the forefront, keep thinking, speaking, acting accordingly, and in due time, it will become developed in you. Amen? Training yourself, exercising yourself unto righteousness. It says in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. Exercise is practice. Exercise is not just knowing about the equipment. It's getting on the equipment. Isn't that right? How often? Once in a while? I'm serious. I really am. All right. So then, acknowledgement. Remember that. So then, in his death, sin nature was Romans 6 verse 6 says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified. Bring that to the forefront of your thinking, that the old man is crucified, and let that affect your thinking, your speech, your attitudes. that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth you should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Acknowledge that. Think about it. Acknowledge that, that I am dead and I'm freed from sin. And it goes on, and it goes on in verse 8 and verse 9, and you need to study it out. Verse 10, for in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God. So when we speak, we talk about there's certain fundamental truths that you got to get a hold of in order to appropriate the sacrifice of Christ. And one of them is Colossians 2 verse 12, recognizing that you were placed in his death, you were baptized and placed into his death, and when he was raised up, you were raised up. Amen, that you were in him. And you being in him in relationship to this sin nature, what it means is that the sin nature was placed in Christ and it was crucified in him. And if it was crucified in him, what is done in him is done in you. What is done in his body is done in his body. And if it was crucified in him, then that sin nature is dead in you. That is why Romans 6:10 says what it says. For in that he died unto sin once. That is why, for he that is dead is freed from sin. That's why it says all this stuff. You follow me? But then you say, but my experience don't line up. We're not talking about the experience here. We're talking about the word. We're talking about truth. You got to get the truth, believe the truth, acknowledge the truth, put the truth in the forefront of your thinking, which says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And when you know the truth, you adhere to the truth, that truth will what? Make you free. You cannot allow and exalt your experience above what the truth of the word of God is. The Bible says again, going back to Ephesians chapter 4, don't be like the other Gentiles. Don't think like them. Don't talk like them. Don't act like most people. They act and think and talk according to the vanity of their minds. And because of that, they don't have God's perspective. They don't have understanding. Their understanding is darkened. They are full of ignorance and it alienates them. So they are non-participants in the life of Christ. Amen? But then it goes on to say in verse 20, that's not what you've learned about Christ. That's not what you've heard. What do you know about Christ? Man, Christ, I mean, you look at Jesus and how he lived. Hallelujah. He was not living for himself. There was no I in him. He was abandoned to the Father. He was submitted, etc., etc., etc. Only what he heard, that's what he spoke. Because there was no sealing coming from self and from flesh domination, the Bible says he had the Holy Ghost without measure. Amen? John 3:34. He had power according to the spirit of holiness. What's holiness? You could think of holiness as the degree to which self is in there. You got zero self in there, that's 100% holiness. We got some work to do. But then you see, that is what creates the sealing. As to how much of all this exceeding great power that is on the inside of our spirit, this life, how much of it is going to be manifested. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19 and 20. When we come to the place where we know experientially the love of God, which means what? We come to such a place in the love of God that self isn't there. What happened? We are filled with all of the fullness of God. We're throughout our entire being. Isn't that right? Think about it. And you say, well, what is the love of God? How great could the love of God be? Jesus said, he gave us a hint. He said in John, I believe, chapter 15 and verse 13, he says, greater love had any man than this, but that he laid down his life for his brethren. Let's break that down. There is no greater love than laying down your life. Simple. So how great a love is great love? Laying down your life. Which means what? No I in me. Amen? And if you think about it, spell me. M-E. Spell I. I. Is there an I in me? No, there's no I in me. I know, whatever. Praise the Lord. Amen? That comes from my basketball coaching days. That says there is no I in team, right? All right. Glory to God, hallelujah. But there is a truth there. Do you get it? Blessed be the name of the Lord. So you are crucified. Now, because you are crucified, there is the end of self-identity. Self-identity. I'm crucified. Who am I? The life I now live is the life of Christ. When Christ, who is my life, shall appear, then shall I appear. You want to know who I am? Not until Christ is unveiled. That's when I'm unveiled. Colossians 3, verse 4. Amen? And then it says, mortify therefore. So, the issue of self-identity, the issue of self-reliance. Oh, I wish I had time to dwell on that one. Self-identity, self-reliance, self-works has a curse on it. Jeremiah 17, verse 5 says, cursed is the man that trusteth in man, that trusteth in the arm of flesh, that makes the arm of flesh his strength, and his heart departed from the Lord. He's going to be like a shrub in the desert. Amen? He'd come, and it just get blistered. But the one whose trust is in the Lord, Jeremiah chapter 17, read verse 5 through to verse 8 or so. But a man who trusts in the Lord, I mean, there could be desert conditions. But guess what? His roots go down deep, and he still has green leaves in the midst of the desert. And even though there's a scorching sun, he's not drying up. His leaves are not withering. Amen? Because he becomes a tree of righteousness planted by the Lord. In other words, the issue of self-reliance, in this world system, we are impressed with that. I'm a self-made man. Not in the God system, you're not. Amen? The life of Christ in you, that is the hope and the expectation. That is the hope of glory. That is the hope and the confidence and the expectation for you to have the fullest expression of God in your life. The full expression of who God has intended and destined for you to be. It comes forth by the wisdom of God. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 7. It is the wisdom that he's ordained for your glory. And that Christ is the wisdom of God and the power of God. 1 Corinthians 1 24. Am I right? And that's what God has ordained for your glory. You know, we just kind of getting this Facebook stuff up, and one of the things that we just put on is the fact that Christ is your future. And if Christ is your future, you want to know what your future looks like? Christ is your future. And it would be a good idea to forget the things which are behind. Hello? All right. Okay, let me show you this. Isaiah 31. Verse 1. Remember, they said it is done by grace. Philippians 3:21 says, Christ, he is able to subdue all things unto himself. And he's not just talking about devils and demons. He's talking about that flesh. He's talking about the enemy that is in the land. You know, when you cross over Jordan, remember, there's a big difference between having legal right and ownership to the land and possessing the land. The possessing of the land, even though the land is yours, you got to drive the enemy out. And even though you've been bought with a price and your spirit, soul, body, mind, will, all of it belong to God, there are still enemy camped out in your mind that you got to drive out. Amen? You got to take the sword of the spirit and drive them out. Isn't that right? Cut off their legs and stuff like that. Drive them out. Right? Set fire to the land. Burn everything up. Remember Jesus having them baptize them with the Holy Ghost and fire. Sorry, this is getting violent. But the Bible says the violence shall take it by force. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, but let me show you something. So anyway, here's what's happening. I'm seeing stuff and I just don't feel like I could go there. Because of, you know, and I feel it's kind of restraining that I can't really go there, and I'm trying to squish it, and so might as well just laugh. Isn't that right? But look at you, look at them again, just to emphasize this point. You are crucified. And you see, when you recognize you're crucified, can you imagine God wants something dead and you trying to revive it? You trying to resuscitate it? Self, God says it's crucified. And here you are, you trying to give it mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. You know what I mean? Because when we get into self-works, self-reliance, self-identity, what we try to do is try to let that dead guy come alive. And that's why we need to have God's perspective and recognize he's dead. He's crucified. He is history. Which means what? From here on, he is history, and it is now about his story. It's now about the story of Christ living through you. Isn't that right? All right. Look at Isaiah 31, verse 1. It says, woe to them that go down to Egypt for help, and stay on horses, and trust in chariots, because they are many, and in horsemen, because they are very strong. But they don't look, but they look not unto the Holy One of Israel, neither do they seek the Lord. You hear seek the Lord, you should hear fear the Lord. They're going down to Egypt. They're trusting in chariots, and as opposed to trusting in the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Now, I'm going to stop at this point. We're going to come back and look at some of the specifics of what is done in his death. Judging every man crucified, 2 Corinthians 5:14. The fact that the world is crucified unto you, Galatians 6:14, and some of those things. We're going to come back and look at the importance of learning how to receive from the power of his death, the power of resurrection, the power of the blood, the power of the name, the power of the life of Christ that is in you, how to receive from the power of the kingdom of God, and to receive, how to receive those things. But on the other hand, because I'm crucified to the world, because the old man is dead, guess what? I don't receive frustration. Don't receive frustration. Don't receive stress. Just rest. Don't receive stress. Do not receive. Why? What? You don't have a legal basis scripturally as a new creation, new perspective, all things past. You have no business whatsoever receiving frustration. You get opportunity, but what do you say? No, thank you. You have the wrong address. I never ordered that stuff. I know you're a salesman knocking on every door in this neighborhood, but bye-bye, you're not going to present to me your goods. And if for some reason frustration got into your house, kick him out. My point is you do not receive frustration. You do not receive stress. You do not, there's certain things you don't receive. Because what is the basis of frustration and stress? Fear, I, me? What about me? What's going to happen to me? I'm dead. Receive from the life of Christ. Receive from the blood. Receive from the name. Now, we're going to come back and amplify that. The curse of the law. Being dead to the curse and so on. But I'm going to skip all of that because I want to get to this. Because at least I want to make this point. Amen? Say the resurrection side. Oh, man, there's so much that I've skipped over. But anyway, I'll deal with that another time. But the resurrection side. Paul's made some because we see this is where we live, and we need to have the mindset of those that are resurrected with Christ, and those that are resurrected in Christ that have a new bloodline, those that are resurrected that are born of him, born of God himself, that are his offspring, those that are resurrected that are crucified, and it is now the life of Christ. How are they to think? What is their perspective? What is their mind like? What is it like? And Paul embodies that in so many ways. But let me go straight to Colossians chapter 1. In fact, yeah, go to Colossians chapter 1, and I'm going to mention something as you go there. Have you ever heard Romans chapter 8 and verse 2? The law of the spirit of life in Christ that makes us free from the law of sin and death. Do you believe that as a new creation we should be living in the law of the spirit of the life of Christ? Don't you think the law that governs the life of Christ himself, his nature, is the law that ought to govern us? Because it's his life. It's not me, it's him. Isn't that right? Okay. So let's consider that question for a moment. Now, I know there are many things about the law of the spirit of life in Christ, faith and so on, and many other things, right? The law of love, etc. But there's something specific I want to show you that I believe encompasses all of them. Colossians chapter 1. And verse 16. Verse 15. Verse 14. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. Do you see that? Verse 15. The firstborn of every creature. Say the firstborn of every creature. Say firstborn. If we go back, way back to Genesis, go back to Exodus and all of that, you will see, I'm in Colossians chapter 1, you will see that God says the firstborn is mine. Isn't that right? That is the reason why, you know, he had certain rules about the tree of life. The firstborn is mine. That is the reason why when Abel brought what? Abel brought a sacrifice. The firstborn, the first one that broke out of the womb. The first calf or sheep that was born, that opened up the womb, that came out. And now there is going to be a new channel of provision for Abel. Because that calf, because now that mother calf was going to keep producing. And this new channel, and he took that firstborn, the first fruits, and he offered it to God, and God was well pleased. Abel didn't do this. Cain didn't do the same thing. He got into trouble. And God had told him, look here, if you would do things right, rather than being angry, I'll accept your sacrifice too. But you come give me some of this secondhand stuff. No, don't accept that. Because what? God says this. You got to understand this. In the beginning was God. God says, I am first. You shall have no other gods before me. I am first. Say, I'm first. That's how God is. God says, I'm first. So Jesus, so the firstborn is his. And we could go back and read about Exodus and all that story that happened in Egypt. The firstborn belongs to God. Remember Abel? Remember what's his name? Abraham. His firstborn in the covenant. Firstborn from the promise of God was who? Isaac. And what did God say? Give it up. Give it up. Give it up. Didn't he? Didn't God ask him for his firstborn? Did Abraham refuse? Is it because Abraham was seeing God's perspective? Amen. Now here is Jesus. He is the firstborn of every creature. Verse 16. For by him are all created that are in heaven, earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, all were created by him and for him. And he is before all, and by him all things consist. He is the head of the what? He is the head of the what? Body. Now, just for a moment, stop and think. He is the head of the body. Now, I'm going to... The law of the spirit of life is this. God is first. Jesus is first. The one that lives on the inside of you, it is not you have passed away. You are history. Now it is his story. He who is first is in you. The nature that you have in this newborn is that of first. God first. We must never violate that. Everything else is connected to that. This is your first. All the other perspectives in our thinking, forgetting those things that are behind, pressing forward, reaching for the mark, coming to know all things, is because he's first. Oh, the gravity of that is so severe that I'll hold off just a little tiny bit and continue. Say, he is first. You got to remember, this is the nature
of him that is in you. And his nature is now your nature, because he is living in you as you, through you.
It's no longer you, but him. First, say first.
He is before all things, and by him all come things. He's the head of the body. Now, he is the head, this is the body. If your finger had a problem, could we cut it off? Would you live? If your arm had a problem, could we cut it off? Foot. Even if you had a problem with your eye, could you take it out? Maybe even a kidney. But what about your head? Can you cut that off? Can't cut that off, can you? You are every part of your body receives instructions from him who is Alpha. He is the beginning. He is first. He is the head. Seek first. So he is before all, and by him all things. He is the head of the body, the church. Who is the beginning? The church is the church, the body of the firstborn. Look at the very nature of the church. Look at who's living in the church. The firstborn. From the dead. Why? That in all things he may have what? Preeminence. First in how many things? All things. Now, let me ask you something. I have a conflict. A conflict shows up. All right? And this conflict takes me over. And this is my priority. I mean, this is my priority over him and everything else. And my conflict becomes first. Have I violated the law? When my conflict becomes first, I have violated this law of first. This law of the very nature of the life of Christ. The law of the spirit of the life of Christ that makes us free. I've just violated that. Why? Because I've made my conflict to be first. What when I have a breakthrough? And by the way, just the issue of my conflict being first. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17 and 18. This light affliction is but for a moment, and it worketh a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory while we what? Look not at the things that are seen, but at the things that are not seen. The conflict is not supposed to be first, no matter what it is. The truth of the word says you're more than a conqueror. This conflict is only trying to separate you from the love of God. This conflict is only trying to come to test, trying to separate you from your faith. Knowing this, that the trial of your faith worketh patience. Come to it all joy. This conflict wants to separate you from the love of God. It wants to separate you from your faith. It wants you to start looking to self and not trusting him. James 1 verse 12 says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to them that love him. Staying firm in the midst of the test and in the trial and coming in the joy and refusing to be separated from the love of God and your faith and refusing to all of a sudden look to the armor of the flesh, remaining firm, God says, is an indication that you love me. And for that, you're going to get a reward, a crown of life. What is he talking about? Because what is this love? Jesus says, this is great love. Lay down his life where there is no self. I've said in what we've been teaching recently, you cannot be filled with the Spirit, consumed with the Spirit, under the government of the Spirit, in your thoughts, in your mind, in your will, where he is governing, he is Lord over all, and you're filled with the Spirit, but self has a rule. Amen? God told people that are born again, speaking with tongues, be ye filled. It means having tongues and having the baptism of the Holy Ghost doesn't make you filled. Hello? Isn't that right? So this, in fact,
We don't have time to turn it, but Isaiah, Ezekiel 48, verse 35, there's a wonderful phrase. It says the Lord is there. Jehovah Shammah. Have you ever heard that? Jehovah Shammah. Who is the Lord? Jehovah Shammah. Jesus is the Lord. And he is to have preeminence in all things. He is the firstborn. He is to be first, not second. Now, if he is to be first, and Jehovah Shammah is the Lord is there, or the Lord is here, then who is here? Who is there? He that is first. So if I'm going to walk in the revelation of Jehovah Shammah, first of all, let me make it easier. If I'm going to walk in the revelation of Jehovah Rapha, I am the Lord thy God that healeth thee, what must I do? I must acknowledge, hallowed be thy name. The blood, the stripes in your back declares that you are the Lord that healeth me. And I must acknowledge that and put it in my forefront of my thinking. Wouldn't you say? So if I'm going to walk in the reality and bring honor to the name Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. The one who is first is there. Then in the forefront of my thinking is, he that is here is first. Do you see the depths of consecration and dedication and sanctification that this produces even in your thinking? Woo, this could bring someone a lot of correction. Do you see why the Bible would say, present your body a living sacrifice? Present your body a living sacrifice. Why would it say, present your body a living sacrifice? I had a thought. Where was it? Present your body a living sacrifice. In other words, you're not your own. You can't just do whatever your body wants to do anymore. You've been bought with a price. And if he is first, your body is not the one that decides, is it? Amen? The law of first says that God is truly first. Real deep. He wants me. He wants you. In other words, listen to this. The God who is first says, I want you. I want you. I want you to be mine. And you said, Jesus. And the gospel comes. And you said, Jesus, I receive you into my heart. I receive you into my life. Now God says, you are bought with a price. You are now mine. He said he wanted you. Now he has you. Now you are his. And now you are his. But he whose you are is first. And because he who is first is in me and is in you, and he is who is first is now your nature, then your nature is him being first. There is a tremendous scripture in James 1 and verse 18. How much time do I have? James 1 and verse 18. James 1 and verse 18 says, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creation. That we should be a sample of what he's created to be consecrated to himself. In other words, you see, when Jesus was raised up from the dead, and we were raised up together with him, he who is first is in us. And as a result, we are first fruits of them that sleep. We are the first fruit because he who is first that belongs to the Father, God says the first belong to me, he is in us, he is our identity, so we are totally his. And we must now abide and submit and humble ourselves to that truth. Even as you have learned of him, do. Isn't that right? Philippians 4 verse 9. And I believe Ephesians 4 verse 21. Romans 8 29 says that the Holy Spirit is conforming us to the image of his Son, that we might be the first fruits. We don't have time for us to examine how we are the first fruits. But it shouldn't be a surprise if he who in us is first and his identity becomes us, ours. Here we are, first fruits. Which means what? We belong to God. I live. Now, watch this here for a moment. If he who is first is now my nature. If he who is first is my nature. Then it's not about me. It's about him and it's about his nature. And I'm living. And he who is first, that is always onto the Father, is an inside of me. And it's his nature. It's natural that, you know what happens? I live to give. I live to serve. It's not my repetition. It's the glory of God. It's the honor of God. He who is greatest among you, let him be servant of all. And that spirit begins to take you over. The conflict cannot be first because he alone is first. The breakthrough cannot be first because he is first. Remember when the disciples came back and said, "Yo, Jesus, the demons are subject unto us." He says, "Chill out. That's good. But I'll tell you what you ought to get excited about. That your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Not because of this victory that you had over the devil, but the fact that he that is first is in you." Amen? Somebody said, "But it's not fair. It's just not fair. You know how hard I work for this and that." It's not about fear. It's about first. It's not about fear. It's about him being first. He is after being first, and we are the church of the firstborn. If we are the church of the firstborn and he is to be first, then no other voice is to be first but his voice. Hence, the voice of the wisdom of the world, the voice of self, the voice of the devil, the voice of the strongholds, any other voice is not supposed to be first. Every thought needs to be brought into captivity. Every stronghold needs to be brought down. Every imagination, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God must come down. And as the Bible says in James chapter 3, verse 15, the wisdom that is beneath, that is earthly, sensual, and devilish, must be silenced. And the wisdom that is from above, James 3, 17, is the one that is peaceable and pure, pure and peaceable. That's the one that needs to rule. We are a sheep. We hear his. And the voice of a stranger, we what? We don't follow. Why? He's first. The Lord is my shepherd. Remember, you who are pursuing righteousness, observe Father Abraham, who had a son. Remember that? Remember him. You get what I'm saying? All right. I know we've pushed the limit, the time, but that thought, if you just get that thought, that this issue of first, then that opens up the door for the rest of the understanding of this mindset and perspective that we are to have. Why Paul would say, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." Why Paul would say in Acts 20, verse 24, that none of these things move me because I count not my life dear unto myself that I might finish my course with joy. Why Paul would say, "Even the things that were gained to me, I count them all but loss, and I just have a laser focused on one thing, that I might apprehend that for which he has apprehended me." And he has apprehended me that the life of his son might be revealed in me and through me. Amen? And just because of that, why all things will become new. Behold, everything becomes new. Because, man, you have on a different set of lens. Everything looks different. The people that you would have otherwise been bowing to, that could have manipulated you, that could have intimidated you, that you could have been seeking to please them, oh, man, you're going to love them with the love of God. You're going to love them as you would God himself. But ultimately, they'll be crucified to you and you'll be crucified to them. And their judgment of you don't even matter. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and I think verse 3, where Paul says, "It doesn't matter who judge me. I don't even judge myself.
Because whatever I do it for the glory of God. I do it not because I'm looking for a reward that comes from man, but I'm looking. I know that the reward of the inheritance comes from him. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 23 and 24. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 23 and 24. And therefore, whatever I do everything in the very person of Christ, in the name of Christ, giving thanks unto the God and the Father by him. Because I'm possessed. I am possessed, Paul says. It's not me, it's him. I am just completely and totally possessed by him. And that's all I want. This is the mark. This is what I'm pressing for. Well, it's not me, but it's all him. I live every moment of my life bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus in my body. And I'm reaching for that mark. So the fullness of the Spirit of God that is on the inside of me might ooze out, and it would become the fullness of God in my soul and in my body, and that my whole being will be sanctified, set apart, spirit, soul, and body, be preserved blameless unto him. And he who has called me, he is faithful to do it. Paul says that's what that's all about. And on that basis, I'm telling you, I count all else but loss. I'm consumed, he says. Are you seeing this? He is first. Say he's first. I'm telling you, if you got nothing else out of tonight, it should be that. That in this new perspective of resurrection, seeing things from his perspective, God is not out there making, saying, let's make a deal. That's compromise. No, God says, I'm first. That's it. And so this law of the Spirit of life, this law of this new nature is God is first. Woo! Are you operating that? Everything else shall be what? Added unto you. It's connected up to operating out of the kingdom. Functioning out of the kingdom. Functioning out of the life of Christ. Functioning out of righteousness, that union. The place where you can function, and all of a sudden God is released to do things that you didn't even pray about or ask about. Hello? Hallelujah! I don't know about you, but that blesses me. I'm so glad I got to say some of that. Praise the Lord! Hallelujah! Blessed be the name of the Lord. That opened up a whole new area of thinking and meditating. Amen? There's an area of giving that I don't know when, but somewhere down the road, regarding first fruits that I feel I need to preach and teach to this church. Because as for myself, I've gotten a little understanding of it, and I've decided I'm stepping into that. Amen? So, Father, I pray for every single one in this place here and on the live stream. That, Father, that this word that has gone forth would just literally break the rocks of rebellion, the rocks of selfishness, self-seeking, trusting in the arm of flesh. That it will literally, that this word would be like a hammer that would smother it, a fire that would burn out whatever needs to be burnt out. And it would produce within us a hunger and an appetite and a desire for sanctification, which is the will of God. A desire to be consumed with you. A desire to be so consumed with the zeal of the Lord that every breath that we take will be pregnant with the truth that we are pressing into this place where we could be possessed by him that apprehended us. Where we could be so consumed that we would be exactly as the Father had desired, that we would be flames of fire that would burn a trail rising above the limitations of humanity and operating in that place of the power of the resurrection while still living in this body, in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for such a wisdom of revelation and sanctification, for a spirit of burning, as it says in Isaiah 4 and verse 4. A spirit of fire in the name of Jesus that will do such a work within us, Father, that any time that when we go to take steps, when we think or we talk or we act contrary to that truth, or that law, God is first, that you would arrest us. It will get our attention, and we will learn to exercise ourselves by practice to have a conscience void of offense before you, because we're walking in that law of God first. and a conscience that is void of offense before God and before man, so that our conscience can develop to such a place of sensitivity that, as Paul said in Romans chapter 9 and verse 1, we are not seared, but we will be in such a place that we can speak the truth in Christ and lie not, and our conscience will bear us witness in the Holy Ghost. Father, let there be such a mighty work of your Spirit in us that begins tonight, that puts us on this pathway. And we know that this is a pathway. You said that this is the pathway of a righteous that becomes brighter and brighter. This is the pathway of the righteous, and you delight in his way. This is the way that you delight in. So, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, this new and living way that you have ordained for us to walk and live in, I release it. I speak it. I declare it in the name of Jesus. And I know Jesus himself has consecrated this way by his shed blood. And I thank you for it. I thank you for it. The pathways that is that we as his workmanship are to walk in. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.